Hi, this is Pat Traylor. I'm the president of the Associated Press Photo Managers here with Bob Lynn for another installment of our Hangout series, talking with leaders in visual journalism about different topics in our field. And today we're talking with Bob about leadership and management and his book and a series of other topics from his epic career. So Bob, do you wanna, I'll have you introduce yourself in a minute.
Sure.
Upcoming, I just wanna plug our annual conference. Speakers are gonna start being announced for that soon. That is October 8th through 11 in Washington, DC. And so just keep, we'll be posting on Facebook and on our website about that coming up. And we've got some more Hangouts in the future, but let's just get into it. So, Bob, do you want to just briefly introduction? Not that you need one.
I don't know about that, but I'll say hello out there to everyone in Radio Land. No, it's not Radio Land, is it? It's some other mystical land out there. Anyway, okay. Are you saying maybe how I got started or a little about my background?
Yeah, just a little bit about your background, you know, like how you got into, sucked into photojournalism, and then just to briefly the papers you worked at,
right,
positions you held, that kind of thing. Just
okay,
just
all right,
and then we'll jump into anything else.
I got my undergraduate degree at Marshall University here in West Virginia. I am from West Virginia. I am from Charleston. I am sitting right here in Charleston right now. But so I went to Marshall and I ended up in journalism. And so I came to my last semester and I need 3 hours of credit to get my credits, get my degree. And excuse me. I needed three credits, and I'm looking, and I said, "Oh, here's photography, photojournalism, and they teach you to develop and print and all like that." I said, "Okay, I'll take that." And I'd been shooting pictures for quite a while, and but from that, I got so much encouragement from. I actually had pictures with composition and that was shocking to the professors, but I got so much encouragement. I said, journalism and photojournalism, let's put them both together. So I ended up, my first job was in Wilmington, North Carolina with the Morning Star. And I lasted on that job for 9 months. until the point, as I recall, I'm standing in the newsroom with my sports editor. There's a big two-man staff, and he had made me a promise that after 3 or 4 months, you made this promise. What about this promise? And he said something. By the way, the managing editor's standing there now because we're having this debate. And he said, "I never made you that promise." And I said, "Well, you're a lying son of a bitch." So guess what? I guess I had maybe at 1 second left at that newspaper. So as if you're lucky, you have somebody up there taking care of you or down there, wherever they are, because 2 days later, I get a letter from the San Gabriel Valley Tribune in California that I had applied to earlier. And this is really crazy. It's how long ago this was. They offered me a job, no interview, just all. And suffice to say, hey, California, here we come. So we're out there now. I lasted on that job for 3 months until my editor decided, and he was a sports editor, decided that he couldn't abide by my creative and imaginative spelling anymore. So, right. So anyway, So in a few days, I had a job over at the Pomona Progress Bulletin as a general reporter that I got to shoot my own pictures. And from there, after 2 years, I didn't get fired. So I broke that chain of events. And I was hired by the Los Angeles Times as a reporter photographer in the San Gabriel Valley Zone Edition. And after a couple of years there, or 1 year there, I guess, I moved on out to the San Gabriel Valley Zone Section as a staff photographer. So my wife, we were out there for about 7 years, and it was a long way from Charleston.
Yep.
And we just had our first child, our daughter, Kelly. So we thought, hey, we need to go back. So on a trip back, I interviewed all around in Ohio and up in Pittsburgh. And I got a couple of job offers, but one from the Cincinnati Enquirer. Excuse me. And so I was with the Enquirer for 11 years. The first about 5 years, it was as a reporter photographer, and then as the rest of the time as a straight photographer. And about that time, I had decided to get a master's degree. So I was getting it through Chuck Scott, the great Chuck Scott. And I get inspired, hey, picture editing. Yeah, let's be a picture editor. So I did. I ended up getting my master's. But
Ohio University.
Ohio University.
My alma mater as well.
So I did. I applied really all around and figuring I'd probably get a job in Nome, Alaska. But I did write a letter to the Charleston Gazette here. Well, they were looking for their first editor. And so I went over, tried out. We liked each other. They hired me. And so that was the beginning of my management career. I was 18 years before that. And anyway, so I came in, said, hey, you guys, I'll just tell you when I was there at the very beginning, the editors, the key editors said, well, probably ought to just fire these four photographers. They're no good. So when I'm there now and I said, hey, I know you do this because you love photography. I know you got talent. I know you're going to do it. You're going to do some great work. Well, that's all they needed. They just needed somebody to believe in them. And that's part of what the book's about. And that sort of thing. And they did. And so the photo report just took off. And my 3 years there, I also redesigned the paper. But I'll get myself down to the Virginian-Pilot. They called and said, hey, could I come down there to the Virginian-Pilot in Norfolk to and do what I was doing in Charleston? So that worked out, and we moved down there, and there's, I guess, in some ways, the rest is history. But I guess we did pretty good down there.
Definitely. So to back up just a little bit, you know, you talked about making the transition from being a photographer into being a picture editor, kind of in your master's. What led to that? What led to that? And then what kind of out of the voices in your head, as you put it in your book, what then translated into your philosophy of running a photo department?
Well, it took me 7 years to get my master's, and going out to Ohio University sometimes at 5 a.m. and getting out there for a 9 o'clock class and that sort. But through that time, Chuck Scott was my inspiration for, picture editing. You run pictures, impact size, content. And when I got to Charleston, I mean, it was just kind of natural. As I say in the book, I'd seen so much not so good management, not where people weren't being inspired at all. And it just kind of like, hey, believe in people and they'll believe in themselves. Treat people like you'd like to be treated. and they will respond. And it, you know, it's all that Sunday school stuff, but I mean, it works. It's like, duh, you know, come on. So, but to do that, like the title of the book is Vision, Courage, and Heart. Well, to accomplish anything in any field, you have to have a vision of what the heck it is you want to do, you want to accomplish. So you have that vision. The courage comes in where you have to have the courage to believe actually first in yourself. And it's not that you think you're hot stuff, but you're comfortable and you believe in yourself, and that'll give you the courage to believe in your staff and other people. And that's absolutely a key. And the heart comes back to treat people like you'd like to be. That's just the heart, you know, just treat people like, and so the bottom line of all that is motivation. And what's the result? A great photo report.
And why do you think it's that so often gets lost in newsrooms?
I don't know. I don't know because you know, there's a culture of bossism, I guess you might call it. And you have seen bosses, an individual, and the boss is this tough, stern, you know, my way or the highway, and I'm the boss, and you better blah, blah, blah. And I just said, gee, that didn't make any sense. You know, these people are motivated to the lowest possible level. And I just said, hey, you know, just treat people right. And so it was just kind of instinctive. It was just kind of there, just made sense all the way along. So,
you mentioned your book, and I want to get to that. So you've authored a book, Vision, Courage, Heart, and right. It is out there, and you're giving it away for free.
There it is, right right there. I am. My wife and I, we self-published in 2013. I spent about a year trying to get universities to, you know, join in their university press. And it was like, well, we love this book, but it's not quite our thing. So we finally said, okay, we're just self-publishing. So we self-published, 1,000. And the next 3 years, 2.5, 3 years, until last June, we had sold up towards 700 books. But January, February, March of like last year, that really fallen off. And this was kind of interesting or strange. I had this idea. I was sitting like I am now in the living room, and my wife, Millie, was in the kitchen. So I walk into the kitchen, and I say, I have this idea. And she said, well, I have an idea too. And she says, we ought to give that book away for free and get it out there. And I said, that's the very idea I had. So great minds or whatever. So we just said, hey, let's do that. Let's just get it out there, because it was never about making money. It was never about, you know, just selling. It was just getting it out there. And so since last June, we have sent out 785 books. So, and we do the mailing, and it's just like, here it is. At this point, we have 15 universities using the book from all over the country, and it's been great. And it was our way, my way, with the career I had, and how it was so great and fun and everything. Let's just pay back to the profession, and we did, and it's been very gratifying.
So if there's somebody watching this right now, how right. can they get a copy?
Well, I guess they can go to, let's see, they can go to Bob Lynn, VCH, at gmail.com.
Okay, cool. And we'll put a link to your website video, so you can just click through that. Get your contact info. So from the book, do you want to talk a little bit about, I mean, you touched on it a little bit, but, you know, your philosophy of, which is the title of the book, Vision, Courage, and Heart.
Right.
Why is that, important you know, in newsrooms today still. Like, these are universal things.
Well, it is universal, and it doesn't matter if your staff's been cut or what. You're still, your job, and this is managed, some managers don't really realize this. Some managers think their job is getting all the assignments covered. No, your job is to see to it that your staff produces really, really good pictures, great pictures sometimes, and that they're used well and effectively in the newspaper. It's not something it goes in the newsroom, I don't have. No, you get out there and you promote and you argue and you make your case why things should, what the advantage is. Pictures, more readership. I mean, a picture's right. So anyway, what was the question?
Yeah, just translating, kind of, these are universal.
Well, it doesn't matter. I mean, yeah, everything's changed now. Everybody's a photographer, videographer. And it doesn't matter because you're still trying to produce the very best work you can and have it used properly if it's, online or in newsprint. So I don't see a change in if that changes, forget it.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, maybe in some places they have, but I don't even like to think about that.
Yeah. Well, no, there's lots of great work still being produced. I think, it's an exciting time. And I think these lessons are maybe even more important now when staffs are shrinking and there's all the noise and daily grind is even kind of more encroaching, more so than usual. So I think it's we need these kinds of lessons and to be reminded about those strategies and philosophies to get us through and not get lost in that grind. Speaking of motivating the staff to produce that great daily picture report, how did you motivate your staff that they're in Charleston and at the Virginian-Pilot to achieve that every day?
Well, like we said earlier, you treat them right. You treat them with respect and consideration. Let's say this wouldn't be the most important, but comes to the schedule. You try to make a schedule that covers what the paper needs to cover, but you also consider their home life, their private life, and you try to make it a schedule that is considerate of them and still does the job. So that would be a little thing. But it's just really a lot of positive reinforcement, a lot of encouragement, a lot of, hey, you're all right, and let's have fun. Let's have fun here. And then you, in the book, you've read about it, the board was the guru or whatever of, the board was a 8x4 cork board that we had in the photo department. And we put the pictures up on the board. Now, a lot different, other newspapers do that too. But what we did, I think that was different. It had to be special. The assignment had to be registered up a little, and then it went up on the board, and it got to the point. Well, we typically would have anywhere from in a week 15 to 25 pictures up on that board, because believe me, go ahead.
And were all the pictures just from that week?
Yes.
Start over every week.
From that week. And I've seen other papers that wouldn't have that many in a month. And probably, which is pretty typical of the papers that aren't kicking ass like they should be. So, and the photographers, when I put the pictures up, I just, under the credit line, I just take a red China marker. I mean, it wasn't any, hey, way to go, any comment, just that. This is who shot this picture. And, it became kind of the living, breathing heart of the photo department. When a photographer walked out that door and they did their assignment, they, by golly, wanted that picture to go up on that board. And so the board really set the standards, and they were high standards. But I will say, what I ask of the photographers, just produce and work at your very highest level. And everybody isn't the same. Some are more talented, some are whatever. So if a photographer that was maybe not as talented as some of the others really shot a good picture for his talent, went up on the board. Didn't talk about it, but it went up on the board because I needed that person to be, hey, encouraged to go out and do it again and again and again. So yeah, the board was really important, and I would encourage anybody that's listening to do that. And as far it just has to have high standards. And one person decided what was going up on the board, and it was me. And not that I know everything, but if anybody had any question why it wasn't my picture, it was me. And it wasn't a committee, you know, determination. It was, and I would recommend anybody do that and get a board somewhere or put it wherever.
So can you, aside from the board, you know, what kind of, just when you're talking, when you're having these encouraging discussions, trying to, you know, if there's somebody maybe on the staff who's really kind of down about the job and about every, you know, aside from, you know, the encouragement of the board, what kinds of strategies were you using to motivate them and get them to buy into?
Well, all what I was just saying, but let's say it ain't happening. Okay. Then that's when, okay, come on, we're going to sit down and talk and maybe actually go out of the office. So it isn't just routine. Maybe go to a park, sit down and say, hey, you're better than this. You can do better. You need to do better. Yeah. And then, there one particular, I think it's in the book, where this one particular photographer, the very nicely talented, said, he gave me some answer. And, you know, I said, well, that's bullshit. And then he said, okay, I know I'm going to do better. So sometimes it comes to that, but that only happened a couple of times. Normally, if you know, you're fighting for them, you're fighting to get their pictures in the paper right, you're going out to the production plant to make sure the reproduction is good on this big, maybe picture page or essay. It's just a lot of little things. And you're in the newsroom really talking to the other editors about this and that and promoting and like that.
Yeah. So just one more thing about the board, actually, and then we'll move on to talking to the other editors. So I think that's obviously a huge part of being a visual manager and leader as well, obviously. But the Ken Lyons, my boss here at the Denver Post, just posted on the Facebook page where people can ask questions. So, of course, if you're watching and you want to ask a question for me or Bob, post it on that most recent Facebook post on our Associated Press Photo Managers Facebook group or Facebook page. But you mentioned the 1.2 point picture system. Can you explain what that is and why you think that's an important distinction to make?
Well, I tell you, it's one of the key things to success. Somewhere along the line, after I'd been at the Pilot a couple of years, it just occurred to me. Actually, I tried this when I was out at the Missouri workshop, and I didn't have my act totally together. I can remember Rich Clarkson and some said, "What? What did you say?" But the idea is, if a photographer, and I say we're all in a room, we're all good photographers, goes out and has this great visual situation, wow, and he shoots this great picture. Well, by God, should. I mean, it's this great situation. You know, your sister, or I mean, your child, your daughter or your son could shoot that picture. But that doesn't demean them. That's good. Hey, you shoot the great situation well. You get 1 point for that. And that's good. That's 1 point. Well, but if you go out to, oh, my God, there's nothing here. it's visually devoid, and you come back with a really good picture. That's 2 points. and that's the difference between the average photographer and the really great photographers. The great photographers come back virtually every time. I mean, they're like bulldogs. They're tenacious. They're going to get a good picture out of every situation, no matter what. And if I can, talk to photographers, that's what you have to, that's where it has to be mentally. And I've had a lot of photographers go, oh, the light goes on. It's not just kind of shooting what's there. And 1 point's important. A portfolio should be maybe half and half. The ones you don't want are the 0 point pictures. The one where you could have shot it walking by and just clicking without even looking. You know, the cliches, right. You bring nothing to the situation.
Gotcha. And yes. Would you, on the board, would you mark that? Would you put like a 1, 2?
No, it's just obvious. There it is.
Okay.
There it is. The board was great. It set the standards. And the other thing it did, since at that time the photo department was off kind of out of the way from the newsroom, but when editors came back there, like, wow, these guys. And, when I went to the Gazette first, but the Pilot, when you go in, you're starting to make changes and doing things different. You know, there's resistance and that sort of thing. But as you work with the editors and now photographers coming in with, wow, these pictures, eventually it gets to be, and it did it, that becomes part of the culture. And everyone's proud of, of what's going on, what we're doing. So it's a win-win thing.
Cool. So let's get back to the other editors in the newsroom. And like you said, facing resistance when you're implementing changes, like if you're at a new newspaper or just listening to this and feeling inspired, I want to make some changes. How do you start going about that, talking to the other editors about pushing, better visual play in the paper,
right.
Doing better?
Well, this wouldn't work every time, but when you have the opportunity, like I did, you pick your own boss. You don't go to work for a paper that you hear this guy says, talks a good game, but he ain't going to back you up. And so, Don Marsh at the Gazette, he said to me, he said, I don't know anything about pictures or layout, but I know we stink and I want you to fix it. So we did. And I'll tell you another little side story. I would take 2 papers at home. One I'd start to mark up and to start making changes and layout and concepts. And no, we don't want to use yellow tint block on stories on the page 1 and things like that. So the chief layout editor was just going bananas, because I would go into one of the key editors who was the most visually astute, and so it'd be kind of tinkers to evers to chance. I'd tell him, and he'd go out. But anyway, this one layout editor one day went into Don Marsh's office and said, it's either Lynn or me. And Don Marsh looks up at him and says, well, Bob Lynn isn't going anywhere. And so you need backing. You need people. You need that guy high up that'll believe. And so when you're working with the other editors, one of the things you do, you have to respect them, even if you totally disagree on a given issue, because you have to understand, where they came from and their training. And so you have to respect them, and you never, ever get up a little higher than them and come down with an attitude. It's because then line in the sand, it's all over for you and that guy. So, and the other thing in the newsroom, when you're making your case for a given picture or use or whatever, you don't use photo terms like visual impact. Visual impact for an editor gets a, oh, brother. So you use their language. You use their language about the picture, just like you would of a good story, good lead, or this makes the emotional connection. Picture will let people know things that they should know. Whatever it is, it's the same. Use words, and that I found was more effective than just being the guy that doesn't know anything but photos.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Well, other than just like arguing for pictures, for, you know, seeing a certain picture, how are you talking to other editors about kind of the systems that you use as a manager, like photo requests? You know, it's always kind of right. Get those photo requests in, you know, or
right. Well, that's one of my favorites. You know. So one of the things that's in the book. Hey, buy the book, everyone, and you'll get a lot of this stuff. But the first thing I did, I just turned the photo assignment practice on its head, because what was happening, which would be typical of a lot of papers, the photo assignments come in and you, okay, that. And so the first seven or eight or whatever, they get done. Now here comes in a heck of a photo assignment. You know, something that's really, really important and good. And I just take it and turn it up. We're going to do the ones that are going to produce the best pictures first. And we'll get to the as much of the other ones as we can. And that was key. That was very important.
Gotcha. Cool. Gotcha. I guess.
Another thing I will say, okay. Thinking about the photo assignments used to be called photo assignments. And I said, no. We don't have an editor saying out in the newsroom saying this is a photo assignment. It's now a photo request. We will decide who and when and what. And that's as you get that respect and people believing in the photo department, I mean, it's not a major issue. Mm-hmm. Anyway.
Right on. Were there, you know, as you're arguing for changes and you're seeing your results, what sort of metrics do you use to measure your results? Or not necessarily numbers, but just your measures of success and in terms of the changes you're implementing?
Well, you're just looking at, you know, you're looking at the board and saying, hell, we're kicking butt. Yeah. I mean, what else? You know, that's it. That's your job. And back to where I said, some photo editors just think getting assignments all done. But your job is to see to it that you produce a great photo report and then it's used properly. That's your job. Period. Now, there's a lot of things you need to do to bring that about and make it happen. But you got to always remember that that's your job. Great pictures, good pictures, great. And get them in that paper right.
Right on.
Why not?
What's that?
I said, why not?
Yeah, right. So would you say that's probably the most important lesson? Just get good pictures, great pictures.
You got to have high standards. Right. So if you don't, if you're maybe a manager that doesn't have high standards, that's a problem. You know, so,
sure.
But you have to have high standards and demand, but not demand like, you know, with a fist, but with encouragement, motivation, a lot of, you know, just treating people right and then praising them, when they do good work. Hey, way to go. Really super.
Right on.
Hey, just one thing you had mentioned at maybe somewhere along the line about the Lou Rain story.
Yeah.
Would you like me just, it's real short, as you know. I'll read it. Is that all right?
Sure.
Okay, because it's real short. Okay. Let's see here. Okay, the title is You Gotta Believe, and this is the subtitle, Lou's Story. Lou Rains was a large, beefy man. More than 6 feet tall, really a bear of a man. He had done some boxing in his younger days and looked it. Most people wouldn't have guessed that he was a newspaper photographer. when I took over at the Charleston Gazette's, paper, when I took over first as their first graphics editor, Lou had been at the paper for many years. Let me get this where I get a little more light on it. I found there was virtually no respect in the newsroom for Lou or the other three Gazette photographers. Oh, they were thought of as nice enough fellows, but competent newspaper photographers? No. And Lou was at the bottom of this second-class totem pole, which meant that morale at the photo department was lower than a West Virginia rattlesnake's belly. So it was, do your job, get no respect, go home, forget it. And the fact was, Lou and the other three photographers were indeed underperforming. Just one more page here. And I thought to myself, no wonder, after years of receiving negative comments and little encouragement, the expectation had become a reality. The truth was, all of these guys had become newspaper photographers because they loved photography, just like most newspaper photographers across the country. But slowly, over time, they had withdrawn into a corner of numbed indifference. Quote, okay, guys, this is a new day, I said to them when I took over at the Gazette. Everyone is starting out with a clean slate. I told them I knew they had talent, I knew they were willing to work hard, and I knew they were going to produce some outstanding pictures. And they did. But for Lou, a man who took life on with pessimistic comic good humor, the new day came slowly. I believed in Lou. I spent a lot of time working with him, using lots of positive reinforcement. Lou was easy to work with. Despite his bear-like presence, he was, by nature, a gentleman. He took constructive criticism well. We worked and worked together, assignment after assignment. I coached, suggested, and looked over every frame. I let him know his images were getting better, telling the story better. He was becoming enthusiastic, happy. One day he came back from an assignment with a lovely set of pictures of a mother working on a school project with her daughter. We edited it down to a three-picture combo. It was Lou's finest work. That night, as he walked down the hallway to the photo department, I yelled after him, "Hey, Lou, way to go. Thanks for the great pictures. The great pictures." That was the last time I saw Lou Raines. He died in his sleep that night. He was 56. A bear of a man who had talent. You gotta believe. And then there's a little subtitle here, and just to finish this up, life is too short. After Lou Raines died, I thought, my God, if ever there was a choice of what kind of manager I want to be, a motivating, supportive, nurturing boss, or a discipline, anyway, you know what I'm saying, a kick-ass boss, it was obvious that it was obvious that life, mine and others, is too short and precious for people to have to live with a rigid, in-your-face, military, my way or the highway management style, or to die with a chewing out as a final farewell. So, Lou Raines, a good guy.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Do you want to talk a little bit more about, after the Gazette and moving on to the Pilot, just a little bit about, how you came in there and just, a little bit, about the success you had there. Obviously, that's a lot of success to talk about, but,
Well, one of the things is back to picking your boss, and that was just a minute ago, I'm going blank on my great editor. Oh, my gosh. It's one of those senior moments. Frank Caperton, who I consider the godfather of every of what we did down there, because he backed me fully. And but you know, when I went in, you don't go in and bowl people over. You slowly, and you work with people easy. And like with the business department, they weren't doing very good on layout. And I suggest, well, hey, can we help you? Let us do that. And I did it for a few weeks, but then I also was in charge of the art department, and I had an artist take that over. So those, I mean, it's just little things like that. I can remember, and I think this is in the book too, the features editor, Ann Hoffman, who's really a good reporter and smart and everything. But for the first 3 weeks, she just, you know, like, who are you? What are you guys doing? You know, don't tell me what to do. But as we worked with her, about the third week, I can remember walking in, she looked up at me, and it was, hey, Bob. Hey, good to see you. What are we doing today? I mean, but so, you know, you just went it over. And so she was a great supporter from then on, and we did some really good work, food sections, the feature sections and all like that. And, you know, it's the whole thing. If you do it right, it's fun. If you do it right, your staff is happy. That we had the photo room, and we had the board up there and in my office, but there was a lot of laughter. There was a lot of people helping each other and talking to each other. And, you know, there wasn't a lot of the little petty jealousies that can develop. Not that it was always perfect, but, you know, sometimes you learn when to get involved, and sometimes you stand back and let two people, if that's what's going on, work it out themselves. So a lot of it's instinctive, but just be smart.
Yeah. Right. Awesome. So I think we're almost ready to wrap up here.
Sure.
Been almost an hour. But, right. You know, would you say that, I mean, I guess that's really the title of the book, those vision, courage, and heart.
Right.
That's like kind of the best tools to push back against the daily grind, or, you know, yeah, just all the troubles that have beset the newspaper industry. I think it's a fantastic book and incredibly relevant today with all the changes that are happening and the ease with that this the fatigue and grind can set in. I think this book is a great tool to push back against that and to remind us about, like you said, why we all got into photojournalism, because we like making great pictures, like looking at great pictures.
It's fun, and you get to meet interesting people, and some of them are famous, but the more interesting aren't famous. I would have young people come and just drop in, and that was fine with me, and we'd talk to them, and in the end it would be just do the best you can, and then hell with it. You know, and sometimes I'd use the F word.
Fair enough.
You know, just give it your all, and don't take things personal. Just know what you're about, know what you're trying to do, and don't get your feelings hurt if people are this, that, or the other. Just be persistently, you know, diplomatic, but boy, you never forget your vision. You never give in to that. And fight, you know, you're not going to be fighting for everything, but fight for those things that are your basic principles and your core values. Fight for them, but in a respectful way.
Of course.
Right.
All right. Well, I think that probably wraps us up. Do you have any final thoughts or parting wisdom for people watching, you know, picture editors out there?
Well, I probably could look over at my notes and come up with something, but because this has been a fun conversation. One thing, like for good pictures, I'm just seeing here, take chances. Have your photographers that take chances. Don't shoot the same old, same old. Take chances. And if occasionally you fail, that's okay too. I know if a photographer came back and said there wasn't anything there, I knew there wasn't anything there. But these photographers come back 9 times out of 10 or more with stuff from nothing. Planning, when you plan, get the photographer in on it as much as possible as far as a story or anything. Don't just say, oh, here's your assignment, but get the photographer in to give her or his ideas, and obviously that they get buy-in to what's going on. Portfolios, just only put in, present the pictures you really like. If it's 12, then make it 12. Don't make it 75. But at 35, they start dropping off where you show where you your limits is, that you think these pictures deserve to be in your portfolio, and they don't. So just put in what you like, and don't try to second-guess that editor you're trying to get a job with. Just right. And be yourself. And have fun.
For sure. Also, one more thing. On the sure. Other end of that portfolio, when you're hiring,
right.
You know, what are some of the strategies you use when you are hiring a photographer?
Well, one thing, I mean, we could pay pretty good, but not like New York Times or LA. And so maybe they can get the very best in the country. Well, I'd go after the best in the country too, wherever it was. But I was more looking for potential. I was looking for potential. That could be somebody maybe would win one of the, like, not zones, but your different, anyway, some photographers are very good and solid, but it looks like they've reached their ceiling. But other photographers may be a little rough around the edges, but you can see their sense of taking chances and doing, and boy, I tell you, that paid off extremely well. With some of these photographers went on to become some of the best in the country, like Beth Bergman Nakamori out in Portland, or Michelle McDonald up in Boston, or now she's the picture editor at the Portland Maine newspaper, and that's fun to see. She's having fun, like, oh my God, what am I doing? Right.
Me too.
Yeah. Okay. Hey, this has been great. It's been a lot of fun. I appreciate you asking me to be on your show, and tell Ken Lyons hi.
Will do.
And he's one of the good guys.
For sure. Okay. Yes. Okay. Great. Well, thanks so much again, Bob Lynn, former picture editor and design director and assistant editor. Numerous titles, Charleston.
Yeah, there was different titles, right?
Virginian-Pilot, and author of I've Got My Copy Too, Vision, Courage, and Heart.
Yeah, very
and
good.
Again, if you want to get a free copy of that book, will be a link on the website, or there is a link on the website.
Yeah, too. I mean, people, they want a book. I'll just mail them a book and be happy to do it, and appreciate their interest.
Right on. Right. And so that wraps up our session. Tune in again. We'll be hoping to have another hangout coming up soon, hopefully with Matt Waite at the University of Nebraska, talking about drone journalism, using drones to take pictures, take great pictures and video as well.
Right.
and all the uses there. And hopefully will be one of our speakers at our annual conference. Again, that our full list of speakers we're hoping to pin down soon. And more details about that you can find on our website, Associated Press Photo Managers. APPhotomanager.com, and that conference again is October 8th through 12th or 8th through 11th in Washington, D.C. So, well, thanks again, Bob, and we'll thanks to everyone for tuning in. So we'll see.
Pat, it's been a pleasure.
All right.
It's been great. Thanks a lot.
You too. Cheers.
Okay. Now, how do I get out of here?